Let us look at a question on thunderstorms. Consider the following climatic and geographical phenomena: condensation, high temperature and humidity, orography, vertical wind. Thundercloud development is due to which of these phenomena? We know that due to high insulation from sun, usually ground is heated up. This gives rise to a low pressure system which gets uplifted, and this upliftment is associated with cumulonimbus cloud formation, which is also called as thundercloud. So if it has sufficient moisture, then the cloud formation will be very intense, and this cloud will be very huge. That is, it extends from about 3 to 14 to 15 kilometers in the troposphere. So this is about thundercloud formation, and along with this we have orographic thundercloud, where the thundercloud is forms due to upliftment of air by the sloping surface of the mountain. In such a case also we see the formation of thundercloud. So all these three options are very obvious reasons. So the answer should be D. Checking fourth option, it is vertical wind. In vertical winds, again, there are two types. One is upliftment, which is the chief reason behind the formation of thunderclouds. So without vertical winds, there is no cloud formation. That is, horizontal winds doesn't form any clouds. Only vertical winds form clouds. But another concept is there is subsidence also along with upliftment in vertical winds. But subsidence is associated with very stable conditions, and it is high pressure at the ground level, and this situation is very stable and there is no cloud formation. Again, if you take it too strictly, then vertical winds can be a wrong option. But here the question is, thundercloud development is due to which of these phenomena? It is only asking about which is a possibility rather than being specific. So even if we can consider 4 as a possible option. So clear answer is D. And there is concept called as downbursts. Downbursts are very common in tropical regions where there is intense amount of sun's energy, along with there is good amount of water vapor content or moisture content available. For example, in regions of Indonesia, Malaysia, etc., and also some islands in the Pacific Ocean which run along the equator. See this significant kind of downburst. In downburst, here we have downdrafts. So this is downdraft, which occurs along a narrow column of air, and this is very violent, that the wind speeds, because of funneling effect or channeling effect, flow at very high speeds, and at the ground they create a vortex ring which is formed due to divergence of air at the ground at a very violent pace. And this vortex ring has wind speeds which are at very high velocities. For example, there are two kinds of downburst. One is macro and the other one is microburst. In microburst, we have this horizontal vertical section which is about 4 kilometers in diameter, and the winds might be about 215 kilometers per hour. In microburst, the winds are much violent, but whereas its thickness is comparatively low, but winds are very violent. So these two phenomena are due to intense downdraft along a narrow channel of air. This is exact opposite of tornadoes, where we have tornadoes. In tornadoes, we have updraft, which is occurs at a very violent pace, and this tornado formation is exact opposite of downburst, where we have this violent wind movement which is formed due to downdraft. So again, these downdrafts influence the climates of tropical regions, as I've already said, that is Indonesia and surrounding regions, and they are very serious hazards to air navigation. So they lead to accidents during takeoff and landings of aircrafts. So we see a lot of flights go missing in this region, especially Malaysia, Indonesia, etc., especially during thunderstorm events, because of this kind of phenomena which are very violent. Along with that, thunderstorms are also a huge mass of turbulence. So when a flight passes through this kind of a thundercloud by accidentally, then it is more prone to crashing. So again, this is also both along with the vortex ring and also the violent thunderstorm can lead to crashing of a flight. And the next concept is hail formation. We know that hail is concentric layers of ice or a ice petal which is formed during thunderstorms. So hail formation is very closely associated with updraft. During updraft stage, it takes lot of wind towards upper levels, and during this process there is intense condensation, and this intense condensation, if it occurs below freezing point, in such a case the raindrops become ice pellets, and this ice pellets when they undergo more and more updraft or upward movement because of violent updrafts, they can move up to a certain distance, and when they become heavy, they fall back to the certain the same levels, and this cycle repeats for a long time until and unless it gains sufficient amount of ice around it. For example, it keeps on building up ice, as we can see in this figure. It builds on various concentric layers, layer over layer. So the number of layers depends on how many times it has undergone upliftment and subsidence. So this single cycle determines how many times it is being uplifted and how many times it has fall back to the original levels. And this complete cycle is associated with layer over layer. So if an ice crystal has, or ice pellet has 10 layers, then it simply means that it has undergone 10 cycles of upliftment and subsidence. And once it reaches a significant size, it becomes very heavy and it overcomes the buoyant force offered by the updraft. In such a case, it falls as ice pellets, especially along with downdrafts. We can see this is how ice pellets fall to the ground, and this is about hailstorm or hail producing thunderstorm. And the next concept is lightning and thunder. So lightning is nothing but that spark we see during thunderstorms, and thunder is very violent sound that we hear. So lightning is formed due to exchange of charge between clouds, as well as clouds and ground, and different regions of the cloud. We know that the clouds have certain charge, and in the upper layers it is usually associated with positive charge in a very huge thunderstorm cloud. And again, bottom layers is also associated with, especially the updraft regions is associated with the positive clouds. Positive charge. So positive charge simply means that it lacks electrons and it is ready to accept electrons, whereas negative charge simply means that it has more electrons than it should have and it is ready to give up some electrons. So when there is electron exchange between positive and negative regions, there is the formation of lightning because of electric field created due to the difference in charges. So again, there can be difference in charges between earth and cloud and certain regions of cloud. Based on these positive and negative charges, we have lightning. And lightning is associated with ionization of atmosphere or the region where it is passing. So ionization is nothing but peeling up of electrons from the outer shells of atoms. We know that atom as a nucleus around which there are electrons which are revolving, and these electrons are arranged in different shells called as K shell, L shell, M shell, N shell, etc. And each of these shells have specific number of electrons. And in the outermost shell, we have certain number of electrons. And when there is lightning process, when there is significant amount of electric field created between these two regions, that is positive and negative regions, then in such a case, there is ionization of this atom. It is nothing but simply peeling off an electron from the outer shell. And this will lead to a deficit of electron in this particular atom. And this atom which has an electron deficiency is called as ions. So this kind of process of creation of ions over a very large scale is called as ionization of air or any other substance. And this will lead to creation of a fourth state called as plasma. We know that there are three states, importantly, that is solid, liquid and gaseous states. Along with that, there is a fourth state which is discovered, which is called as plasma. So the plasma state is usually occurs between when there is lightning formation. Along with it, plasma state is also observed over the sun's corona. So sun's corona is a thick cloud of ionized gases. So ionization is associated with plasma, and lightning give rise to ionization of atoms. And thunder is nothing but a shock wave which is created due to significant increase in pressure over a very short span of time. For example, this lightning process is associated with heating up of atmosphere, and this heating creates a very huge pressure which is much, much greater than the ambient pressure offered by the air. As a result, this huge pressure is released in a very violent way, which gives rise to thunder, or that very violent sound that we hear during thunderstorms. So thunder and lightning are very important, and they can play a very devastating role on various objects as well as human life. For example, if they strike trees or various other structures, they can simply destroy them. For example, trees get burnt very quickly, that is because of high electric field as well as high temperatures at which the lightning happens. And along with that, the lightning has capacity to even destroy huge structures which are very tall. You can see, for example, we have this metallic rod which is associated with the twin towers, that is New York trade centers, World Trade Centers. And this particular electric material is very important because it has the capacity to channelize this lightning towards the rod. As a result, it doesn't affect the buildings. And again, we can see there are no such structures on other buildings because there is already a huge metal rod here. So this huge metal rod can protect all other neighboring buildings. So what happens during our normal stages where we have small houses? We know that small houses have structures in their neighborhood like electric poles, trees, etc., which are quite higher than the houses. As a result, such houses are not affected by lightning and thunderstorm. But if the house size grows significant, that is, if it has 5-10 floors, in such a case, and if there are no significant trees in the region, and if the electric poles and mobile towers are shorter than the buildings, in such a case, instead of lightning striking these metallic rods, it might strike the building, damaging the structure. So usually any high-rise building is associated with this kind of metallic substance to save the building from the lightning process. So this is all about thunder and lightning. The next important concept is tornado. Tornado is associated with thunderstorm formation, and it is violent in certain regions like Tornado Alley in USA, which is about southern central part of USA. And other than that, we have tornadoes in almost every part of the world except Antarctica, where the temperatures are too low to create a thunderstorm. But tornadoes are less violent in other regions, and they are very violent in Tornado Alley of USA. And here we have a small, very narrow column of air, which is formed due to convergence between updraft and downdraft. So we'll see that with a figure. It is a small diameter column of violently rotating air and is in contact with the ground. So this is nothing but tornado, and occurs most often in association with thunderstorm during the spring and summer. So thunderstorms are the primary reason behind creation of tornadoes, and it occurs between spring and summer. So spring is the season between winter and summer, especially in the mid latitudes of both northern and southern hemispheres. These whirling atmospheric vortices can generate the strongest winds known on Earth. So wind speeds again reach up to 500 kilometers. So they are very violent. You might have observed in news whenever there is a tornado strike on certain regions of USA, we see large scale devastation. So it is a natural disaster, again often referred to as twisters or cyclones. So let us see the formation. We have a violent updraft here, and there is a violent downdraft because of very intense thunderstorm formation. In such a case, there is convergence between updraft and downdraft. So this convergence between updraft and downdraft creates this spiraling effect of wind, which happens at a very narrow region. And this spiraling effect is so intense that the wind speeds can reach about 300 to 500 kilometers. And as all the wind is channeled through a very small column of air, it becomes more and more violent, and it can cause huge destruction at the ground level. So this is about thunderstorm formation. It is formed due to convergence between updraft and downdraft. So this is the region where it is converging, and it is creating the spiraling effect of wind movement towards the updraft. Coming to distribution, they are very rare in polar regions and infrequent at latitudes higher than 50 degrees north and south, because here the temperatures are very low. And below 50 degrees, we have another phenomena like jet streams, etc., which aid in the formation of thunderstorms and other cyclonic systems. The temperate and tropical regions are the favorite ones, because in tropical regions, we have high temperatures. In temperate regions, we have phenomena like jet streams, which can influence the formation of cyclonic conditions like thunderstorms. And tornadoes have been reported on all continents except Antarctica. United States has the most violent thunderstorms. And again, this is about, and at any moment, there are about 18,000 thunderstorms in progress throughout the world. So it is not a very strange phenomenon. It is very common. It occurs all around the world except Antarctica. So this is Tornado Alley, that is Allevy, not Valley. Not Vallevy, it is Allevy. This is called as Tornado Alley, this particular region where thunderstorms can be very violent, and large scale destruction occurs in this particular region. And water sprout is nothing but a thunderstorm which occurs above a water surface, where we have this intense column of spiraling air. which is formed due to convergence of updraft and downdraft, which occurs over the surface of water. So it seems as if it is sucking up a lot of water, but in reality it doesn't suck any significant water, but it only takes up certain moisture or humidity which is available in the wind. So water spout is a tornado on the water surface. And again, there can be many such columns. As we can see, it is not about just one single water spout. Even in the case of tornadoes on Earth, they can be single or multiple tornadoes occurring at the same time. We can see the same kind of thundercloud forming multiple columns of air. And again, it depends on the strength of tornado. And in water spouts, this is very common phenomena. And till now, we have seen about convectional rainfall. In convectional rainfall, we have seen about thunderstorm formation, which is chief example for convectional rainfall. And in thunderstorms, we have a downburst, upburst, downdraft, updraft. Along with that, we have seen about downburst, and then we have seen about tornadoes and water spout, lightning, thunder. All these concepts fall under convectional rainfall. And now we have orographic precipitation. This is one form of precipitation which is quite similar to orographic thunderstorm formation, but here the cloud formation might be cumulonimbus or any other cloud form like nimbostratus. So here again, the same example, we have this rising air creates condensation, and condensation gives rise to cloud formation. So in orographic thunderstorms, we have cumulonimbus clouds which is established, whereas in orographic precipitation, it might be a cumulonimbus cloud or a nimbostratus cloud. So nimbostratus cloud creates precipitation for a long time and it covers a huge area, whereas cumulonimbus cloud is confined to a very small regions, but it is very as a great vertical extent. And if you look, the region which receives significant amount of wind during this upliftment process is called as windward side. Usually this is windward side, which has very good vegetation because of significant rainfall. So when the cloud reaches the upper layers, here the condensation is more or less negligible because it is no more subjected to upliftment. When there is no upliftment, the condensation process ceases. And when this wind slides along this slope of the other slope of the mountain, which is called as leeward slope, there is no upliftment here because there is no agent that can cause upliftment, and there will be no significant condensation when there is no upliftment. And when there is no condensation, there is no rainfall. So leeward side doesn't receive any rainfall. Along with that, when this wind is moving downwards, it is subjected to greater atmospheric pressure as it moves downwards, and this also is associated with lot of pressure on the wind, but still this pressure results in subsidence, not upliftment. So we need to have negative pressure to uplift to get an air uplifted, whereas here it is positive pressure acting on the air parcel. As a result, this air parcel keeps on falling. Along with that, it is very dry and cold, so it is comparatively denser, so this also makes the wind fall along the slope of the mountain. And this sloping wind movement or the cloud movement is called as katabatic wind. Katabatic wind is simply occurs along the sloping surfaces. Both this rising wind and the falling wind is called as katabatic wind, wind that is associated with the orographic barrier. So in katabatic wind, that is the subsiding katabatic wind, it is very, sometimes it is cold because of in contact with high capped mountains. In other cases, it is very warm and dry, has no significant moisture in it. So this is very important in the concept of rain shadow effect. So the regions in this side, we have significant rainfall. On the other side, that is leeward side, we have no rainfall, and this can give rise to various dry regions like Patagonian desert, which is an example for a desert which is formed due to rain shadow effect. Along with that, there is another desert called as the most driest place in the world, called as Atacama Desert. Even this desert's formation is associated with this kind of phenomena where the wind doesn't bring any rain because of rain shadow effect. And other than this kind of, you know, convectional and orographic precipitation, we have frontal, cyclonic and monsoonal precipitation. In my previous video, I've explained what is frontal precipitation. I've explained about front formation, that is cold front, warm front, stationary front and occluded front. So all these fronts are associated with cloud formation and rainfall. It is nothing but frontal precipitation. And cyclonic precipitation, we'll see in detail about tropical cyclones. Then we'll study what is cyclonic precipitation. And we have monsoonal precipitation. We know what are monsoons. There are two kinds of monsoons, southwest monsoons and northeast monsoons, which are acting on India. Both these monsoons bring rainfall, but the southwest monsoons bring rainfall to whole of India, not particularly this particular region doesn't receive significant rainfall. due to southwest monsoons, and northeast monsoons brings particularly rainfall to these regions, the Andhra and Tamil Nadu coast. And other than this, not other areas are not significantly affected. So this we'll study in detail when studying about Indian monsoons. There are a lot of factors associated, like jet streams and large scale convection cells. So we'll see that all in detail. So this is all about precipitation. And coming to world distribution of rainfall, so while studying about climatic regions, we'll see this in detail. But now just remember that during this region where there are equatorial rainforests, and this region has good amount of precipitation because of the intertropical convergence zone. Again, this region is also under the influence of intertropical convergence zone along with Indonesian and Malaysian islands. And this particular region, because of monsoon winds, receives good amount of rainfall. India in particular receives rainfall only due to monsoon winds. China, this part of China which has good amount of rainfall, also receives winds due to monsoon effect as well as the winds that are coming from Pacific Ocean. And Japan again receives good amount of rainfall because of northeast monsoons, which bring quite a good amount of rainfall, and also winds from Pacific Ocean. So we'll see all these in detail by studying about climatic regions. And these regions which are under the influence of subtropical high pressure belt and offshore winds give rise to deserts. So these are deserts due to subtropical high pressure belt, Australian desert, this thing Kalahari desert, and certain parts of Atacama desert. Atacama desert is formed mainly due to rain shadow effect, and along with that it is in the regions of subtropical high pressure belts. And we have these deserts, interior deserts, which are formed due to continentality. Because of their interior positions in continents, they don't have significant rain bearing winds which are reaching them, and hence these are deserts. So we'll see them all in details, which are closely associated with precipitation process. And this is all about the concept of precipitation. In next video, I'll be explaining about tropical cyclones, which is a very important concept. And in this video, I think you have liked the explanation on precipitation. And if you liked it, please give a like and don't forget to share and give your feedback. This is very important because I'll have an understanding whether this is easy for you to understand or not. And subscribe, because I'll be posting more videos so you can get quick updates of all my videos. And this is all about precipitation. Thanks for watching.